Hello, I'm Georgia Shakti Hill, and I want to welcome you to Living in Balance. You know, we love our arts and entertainment series, and today we're going to be meeting a musician. And it is the music that does heal our soul, is it not? Now, this particular musician has written music for NASA, for Coca-Cola, for Disney, for Lucasfilms, even for the U.S. Navy. He plays music that will move your heart, that will just enthrall you. So do come join us, John Seary, Into the Blue. Into the Blue is the name of this show today, and it is John Seary that we are welcoming, and it's wonderful to have you with us.
Very nice to be here, John.
We are talking about space music, outer space, inner space. We're talking about music that you have created from your wealth of background, and you started on a church organ.
Started a long time ago when I was about 7 years old on piano, and then moved to church organ when I was about 10. Uh-huh. Played church organ until I was about 13 or 14, then got caught into rock and roll fever.
Yeah. But classical music was your background.
Classical music was the foundation for it all.
And it really makes a wonderful foundation for all music, does it not?
It sure does.
But rock and roll, when you're a teenager, that's, you have to do that.
Yeah, it pushes the boundaries of what you learned in classical music and takes kind of the straitjacket thing away from it a little bit.
Yeah. And from that, music has really been your life. You've been able to create music then, and especially what's referred to as electronic music.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now when we're talking about synthesized music, electronic music, what are we talking about exactly?
We're talking about music that is made from electricity and the movement of electricity through electrical circuits. And with a piano, you have control with your hands through the expression. You can bang on it louder, you can play it soft, you can bring all kinds of expression to it. With electronic music, you have to design the expression into it. So I have a statement that I use. I say, controlling the beast.
Ah, okay.
And the beast has many, many areas in electronic music. So as an electronic musician, you must learn how to electronically control feel, velocity, duration of the notes, all of that has to be designed into it.
Well, there's a scientific aspect to it then, and you're mm-hmm. very familiar as far as with the machines, is
right.
what you're talking about too. But you have to keep it personal, because there's also like the man who's there too.
Right.
Okay, because the machines can just sort of do their thing.
The machines can take over if you let them.
Okay. Now, when you say ambient space music, because mm-hmm. they talk about space music and John Seary. So tell me about that.
Well, with space, you've got an infinite variety of space to work with. No limits. And usually with traditional music, you're working with notes and melodies and framed music. But with space music, you're letting all the boundaries go. All of the notes come in very slowly and leave very slowly. And you're creating an atmosphere. You're creating a painting with it.
But they say that you actually, like, are cosmic in the way that you're able to hear the sounds of space mm-hmm. yourself personally, and then your creative genius is how you then bring that to the average person through
right.
your music. So how does John hear the sounds of space?
Well, what I do is I have an artwork book, and I look at pictures. You know, and to me, those pictures are sheet music. If there's a picture of, you know, the Earth and all of its glory going in around the sun and all the rest of the planets following it, there's a part of my imagination that just goes, what does that really sound like? If I was standing over on that planet looking back toward Earth, what would I feel?
Okay.
And so you take all that, and somehow through the magic of imagination, it goes from a visual scene into a musical scene.
Now, you love this.
Yes.
Okay. So there is also an aspect to your music that is called romantic music.
Right.
Now, not everyone would think of outer space and romance as really mm-hmm. going together, but how do you blend that? How do you bring that love to it?
Well, what I see is I remember as a child what I felt like when I was looking at a deep sky with all the stars shining and the feeling in my heart that I had. And going through life and falling in love with another person felt exactly the same way. And I noticed that, you know, yeah. music can be used to channel both those areas, the infinite love that you feel inside of yourself, you know, in the infinite space that you see when you're outside. One and the same feeling to me.
You know, and I hadn't thought about that, and I read a really nice interview from a magazine that you had done. And when you expressed it like that, I really understood what you meant, because that is that feeling when you look at the stars and you see that gorgeous, the skies, it really does move your heart. So it's not unlike being in love.
Absolutely. It's the same feeling to me.
Yeah. Now, outer space, inner space, and when we talk about those and your music, what are you talking about? Is there that blending then? Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. It seems that the human body sometimes is a conduit, and you use your eyes and your senses to gather all of the beauty. But somehow that beauty comes together and focuses inside, so that the human body itself, the interface between the inner and the world, disappears. And all that's left is that flavorful love that just exists inside.
I like that, flavorful love. Now, you have two new CDs, and you're going to share with us and tell me a little bit about them and your latest music. Where are you creating now?
Well, the first one, Century Seasons, is really a wrap-up of 20 years of doing space music. It's a double CD release with 9 cuts on it. And the average length of the cuts is 6 minutes and beyond. So what I did was design it so all the pieces of music blend in together. So it's one continuous listening experience.
Oh.
And it sums up everything I've learned about music. And it just starts here and it ends there. And in between is this wonderful journey.
Now, what are we going to hear today?
You're going to hear pieces from Century Seasons. A piece I have picked out is called Deep Mystery.
Deep Mystery.
Which is something I came up with when I was on the island of Kauai.
Ah.
And I was looking at the ocean coming in and all that. The music just kind of appeared like that. I went back with the studio and did it.
Okay, well, we're going to listen to it.
Okay.
If we will. So that is the mystery, the deep mystery.
That is the deep mystery.
And you were moved by the beauty of Kauai. But you said it's really a culmination of all of your work. I wanted to go back to one planetarium, one that was very special, of all the special things that you have done. And that was in honor of Christy, is that?
Christy McAuliffe.
Yeah.
Who was the Challenger Teacher in Space program.
Uh-huh.
We were involved in the Teacher in Space program for a year before it happened. So what was going on is we had all the planetariums in the country that had video capability wired into NASA from the shuttle on down. So a lot of the planetariums were just packed with school kids waiting for Christy to teach in space.
Oh, yes.
So when that happened, it was devastating. No one really knew what was going on. I had stopped playing music for about 2 months just to heal up. And all the music that I had done for the Teacher in Space program needed a reason. So I assembled it all into the first album and called it And the Stars Go With You. And what was really nice is that 2 years later, they decided to build the Christy McAuliffe Memorial Planetarium in Concord. And they used that music for the opening show and all the other things that went on. It was a wonderful moment.
But you've talked about planetariums as being so important in your life, because that was your first real expression of your music through the planetarium system, where you really realized that there was a market out there for the talent that you had.
Yeah, because what you could do is you could take the entire sky and you could condense it into a sensory experience that somebody could come in and experience sight and sound, star fields, planets. And I said, what a place to just give free rein to your creativity. You know, to be able to speak the language of music through the stars.
Yes.
It's really, really important to be able to do that and to not forget, you know, the beauty of the night sky and to bring it home to somebody.
And I love you keep asking that question, and who are we?
And who are we?
And one other thing, the mothership process. Just can you give us an explanation of what you refer to when you're calling it the mothership process?
Well, if I go out on a beautiful starry night and the stars are just, you know, brilliant diamonds in the sky and the heart just opens and you feel it just come out of yourself and just up into the night.
Okay.
And that same feeling, you know, happens when you fall in love with somebody.
Okay.
In my opinion, only it almost kind of reverses itself and comes into the body.
So you keep coming back to space and romance.
Mm-hmm.
But that's kind of like, also you said, like it's a combining of the heart and the mind.
Right.
Yeah. And that's what you do as the musician.
Sure.
As the scientist. Yeah. And a little bit of astronomer in there too, I would think.
Yeah, absolutely, because I've done so many planetarium shows. I've gotten a free education in cosmology, just listening to it over and over again.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we enjoyed listening to that. We're going to do another cut in our next segment. So what I'd like us to do right now, though, if you will stay tuned, we're going to take a break. And when we come back, there will be more of John Seary, Into the Blue, and more of that space music. And if you are just joining us, I'm Georgia Shakti Hill, and we're talking with John Seary, and we have gone Into the Blue, which is his space and romantic music blended together. And we're going to talk a little bit about love, time, and technology. And you have two CDs especially that you want to share about Exlandia and Midsummer.
And Midsummer Century.
Century, yes.
Well, back in 93, at one time I was doing a planetarium show that combined those three ideas together, love, time, and technology. And I said, what if you were to create a romantic story using space music and combining something as soft and wonderful as love with something as esoteric as time and something as complicated as technology? How would they all fit together? So the music really tells a story a la Star Wars about a long ago, far away romance that took place between two powerful beings, and they created this city, something like the Taj Mahal. And in the city, they invite lovers from far distant time and places to come together to experience true love. And the music acts as like a soundtrack to that whole idea. And without, you know, spelling it out in words, the music can take you into these soft and glorious places.
Ah, so that's your style then of how you create. You come from that and you have your story, and then your music goes with your story without words.
Yeah, it goes back to working on planetarium productions where you had a narrator. And all the music was designed to what the narrator was saying, but I used to have a lot of fun pulling the narrator out and letting the music just tell the story, and that became the basis of my style.
I see, okay. Now we also have a dear friend is a part of the Spirit Keepers. That was one of yours, and also you have And the Stars Go With You. Now that was the one that you mentioned with Christy, that
yes,
you put the music
McCall's
together, and the Stars Go With You. And Spirit Keepers, now that's a little bit of a different genre for you.
Spirit Keepers was a real surprise for me as well, because in 1996 I was invited to go up to an ancient Indian burial ground in the North Georgia Mountains. And subsequently I stayed the whole summer. And I built teepees, and we built fires, and I got into the Indian way of life, which was totally opposite from what I was involved with technology. And I said, well, wouldn't it be good if you took space in the Native American culture and blended them together?
Oh, yes, and they were always looking to the heavens, to the stars.
And so we built this whole thing with Spirit Keepers, where the music reflected the space, you know, and the space was brought down to earth and mixed in with the Indians. And I was living the whole summer putting together the music and actually being there. It was great.
So John had a new experience, and so we had a new sound.
It was wonderful.
Okay, we're going to go again to another one of your new CDs, and we're going to hear a cut from that. And tell me what we're going to be listening to. It's Hidden?
Hidden World.
Uh-huh.
This is a Narada release. And this is another one of those spontaneous experiments, just like Spirit Keepers, where I was in the middle of another project. I got a call from a friend that said, I've got some lovely percussion tracks and some flute tracks, and why don't we put together this Middle Eastern type world music? Okay. And I said, you're on.
Okay.
So within about 3 or 4 months, he had done the percussion and the flute out in Seattle, sent it to me. I hadn't even met this gentleman yet. I put the keyboards, mixed it, we sent it to Narada, and they loved it. Uh-huh. And out of nothing came Hidden World.
And what are we going to be listening to right now?
Going to be listening to the first cut.
Okay.
Called Hidden World. And it's a combination of a special kind of flute that Gary manufactured out of a huge piece of metal pipe. And then only he knows how to play this thing.
Okay, so now it's Hidden World.
It's Hidden World.
We will listen. Of course, I'm a flute person and percussion, and to have that all blended so beautifully together into Hidden Worlds.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I did mention that you have a propensity toward the study of science and astronomy and in
yes.
the cosmos. And there is one thing I wanted you to explain, because I thought it was fascinating,
mm-hmm.
the force of tachyon. And the force of tachyon is really about being in two places at the same time, like
yes.
bilocating, but this is like scientifically proven?
Yeah, physicists have proved that tachyons are the only living, you know, you can't really even call it a particle, but the only living entity, let's say, that can exist simultaneously in two places at once.
Mm-hmm.
And that just fell right into my idea of what love is.
There you go again, John, being romantic.
I just can't help it. It's one of those things.
Okay. And that concept of the romance of...
Yeah, the romance of the universe unto itself.
Uh-huh.
Where, you know, here's an entity or an article that can be in two places at once, two people who are in love with each other, same exact thing that's going on. And musically, I just love describing that whole process.
Yes.
It's the same thing of standing in the middle of an ocean looking up at a star field.
Mm-hmm.
You're out there as well as you're here.
Mm-hmm. And you keep seeing that outer space, inner space relationship between us and space and
mm-hmm.
our bodies and so forth. I like that. Now, there are many uses, and I love this, the mm-hmm. uses of your music. Now, people enjoy listening to your music for different reasons. As
mm-hmm.
I said, I caught it on our small satellite dish on the Atmospheres channel,
mm-hmm.
and I love just having it as background when I'm doing my work, because that makes me better as far as working.
Right.
But meditation is one of those areas that you say people meditate to your work, and you get feedback from people all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah,
well,
fans.
The thing that I've learned about meditation is that you've got, especially meditating on music, you've got sound and silence.
Mm-hmm.
And the good composers know when to use silence and when to use sound. And they know how to take the music that they're doing and mix it in production a certain way so that there are holes and spaces that a person can rest in.
Yes.
And not be distracted by too much melody or too much overproduction, but to have just enough space, just enough silence, so that they can fall into the music.
Oh, I love that. I didn't realize that you consciously were doing that for us.
Yeah, because I would say to myself, what kind of music what I like to listen to when I'm meditating. What, how do I want it to affect me? Uh-huh. And then because I knew about how to make music, I designed it.
Well, you know, and it's very popular right now from mm-hmm. the medical perspective to use music in healing, and right. it's being accepted by our allopathic Western physicians.
Mm-hmm.
And tell me about that with your music.
Well, with that, you've got, once again, the power of silence working for you. And usually in music therapy, you want people to experience a sense of silence while they're listening to music. They don't want the music to tear at them. They don't want the music to drag them into areas. They want music to be able to suggest heightened states of consciousness.
And I love that music always brings me back to center, too. Mm-hmm. It's very, very balancing. And when we're out of harmony, it can bring us literally right. back into that peaceful place. And putting babies to sleep.
Absolutely.
You've had mamas say, oh, thank you, John.
They do. They write to me and they say, there's that one piece where the baby just closes the eye and they're gone.
Uh-huh. And what
and
is
and to
it?
Me, it's a wonderful thing because I can identify with that. That's uh-huh. what I want the music to do to me.
Yeah.
You know, take me away, put me to sleep.
Ah, I like that. Mm-hmm. Now, also, it's been used in hospice programs for people who are mm-hmm. going to, who know that they are going to be passing over soon. And so there, then it is also for them.
Yes. There are some pretty magic stories. There was a person about 4 years ago that her last will was to take And the Stars Go With You into a room by herself, put on a set of headphones and pass.
Mm-hmm.
And then she wrote to me about that.
And how gentle a way to go.
It was just a wonderful thing.
Yeah. And prenatal care. Mm-hmm. So it's good for the babies. The babies also enjoy.
Oh, sure. And now they have headphones that are designed for the
yes.
woman's stomach.
Right.
And they place them across there. And if you've got a great stereo mix going on inside your music, the baby will pick that up and just feel like, you know, it's swimming inside there.
Yes. And last, substance abuse program. So how mm-hmm. wonderful that you've been able to assist people who are, yeah.
And all of this is kind of in like non-conscious, just this right. is the kind of music that I would like to hear in these kind of states. So now that I know about how to make it, I can share it.
Well, we appreciate that so much. Thank you. And if you would like to be in touch with John, and we always love to hear from you too, stay tuned, and then we'll also have some parting thoughts. Always so appreciative of our artists and our musicians because they really do affect our lives so positively. Living in balance in mind, body, spirit is so much easier when there is beautiful music to take us there, to take us where we want to go, where we need to go. Until next time, I'm Georgia Shakti Hill, and may you be well, happy, and peaceful, and perhaps romantic and taken into the space.